Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming to this, the second in our Smart Women, Smart Power series here at CSIS. I'm Kathleen Hicks. I run the International Security Program and am the Henry Kissinger Chair here at CSIS. We are here on an Ash Wednesday, so I have not misapplied my makeup. So thank you for that in advance. And thank you also for braving the cold weather we've had here in Washington. More cold is going to come, I think, while we're here, but I hope you will be warmed by the great conversation that we've put together for you tonight. I want to thank in particular Citi, who provides sponsorship for this series and without whom we could not put on this event this evening. We have put up for you for Smart Women, Smart Power our Twitter handle, which is at Smart Women, and of course, we are broadcasting this live via webcast. And tonight, it's my pleasure, most importantly, to introduce our two speakers, most importantly, the First Lady of Afghanistan, Rula Ghani, here for the first time at CSIS. As a native of Lebanon, she met her husband, the president of Afghanistan, when they were students together at the American University in Beirut. She is quite accomplished as having earned her master's degree in journalism from Columbia University in New York. And of course, she's worked extensively on women's and children's issues in Afghanistan, and I'm sure she'll be sharing those experiences with us here tonight. Providing the moderation for this evening is, as always, Nina Easton, who helps us host this Smart Women, Smart Power series. Nina is a senior associate here at CSIS, and she's also a columnist and chair of Fortune's Most Powerful Women International Summit. So please join me in introducing and thanking our speakers for tonight.
Thank you all for coming, and thank you, Kath, for that terrific introduction. I just wanted to give one shout out to one other piece of Smart Women, Smart Power we do, which is a weekly podcast. You can find it on Apple iTunes. It's right on your smartphone, and it's a great way to hear women talk about pressing foreign policy matters of the day. Well, thank you so much for being here, Mrs. Ghani. It is just, it's truly an honor, and it was delightful to get to know you a little bit over the course of a couple of these days. It's interesting because your predecessor, the previous First Lady, she was a doctor, professional woman, but never seen in public. You've come in in the last many months and become quite visible, and have been accused of making waves, which we like to hear. Let's start with that. What is your vision for how you want to be First Lady?
Okay, first I'd like to say that I'm very glad to be with all of you tonight. I hope that I will not disappoint. I would like to say a word about Mrs. Karzai, Dr. Zinat Karzai. She's indeed a doctor and she's an accomplished professional person. She happened to be in her childbearing and child-rearing years during the time her husband was president. And I remember when I was in my child-rearing and child-bearing years, I didn't have time for anything else. So if she chose not to have a public life, I think it was her choice. And I don't think she should be blamed for that. Anyway, coming back to me, once I moved to the palace, I found that if I stayed at home, I would be just waiting for my husband to come back at night. And you may know that my husband is a workaholic, and that he will not come back till maybe quite late. And I very quickly got bored. So with his encouragement, I decided to have an office. And slowly this office has grown. We now are 7 women, young and old. I'm the old one. we decided to have an open door policy. So basically, I see my role more as a listener and as a facilitator. I don't have a budget. People don't come to me to get money, but they come to me to talk, to share their concerns, to sometimes voice their complaints, sometimes just to let me know what they're doing. And it's really wonderful because I've had women and men, mostly women though, and a lot of young people come and see me. Maybe it was a novelty. They wanted to see who was that person who was had become the first lady. Might be the reason why there are so many of you around here tonight, anyway. But also to have a chance to talk about what is worrying them or what is interesting them, their hopes, their misgivings. So in the first phase, this is what my office does. It's just kind of welcome people, listen to them. And in the cases where we can help, where it's an easy way of helping, like for example, picking up the phone and obtaining an appointment for them in some government agency. We do it, and we have helped quite a few people. Not too many, but still, we've made...
And what have you learned about the country and the state of the country in this listening tour that you're doing? You and I talked about the widening gap between the provinces and the urban centers, for example.
Yes. The first thing I discovered is that there are a lot of very strong women who are determined to better their lives. That is, you know, it is something that does not come in the press because the press, for some reason, is like a broken record that keeps saying, you know, poor Afghan women. And it's true they are facing very difficult situations, but they are facing them with a lot of resilience, with a lot of strength, and with a lot of resourcefulness. Through their talks, as you mentioned, yes, I realized that there is a widening gap between the urban areas and the provinces, especially the far-flung provinces. Women would come to me and say, "You have forgotten us. Nobody comes and help us. We don't have access to medical services. We don't have access to education, let alone legal services or other kind of more sophisticated services." You see, a lot of the teachers in the provinces are men. And in many of these provinces, many families will not send their daughters to a classroom that's led by a man. The solution is very easy, is to train local women to become teachers. First, elementary teachers, then middle, then upper, you know, higher school. We don't need to think about university yet, but there is a need to concentrate on these women. And I worry because if ever the gap increases, we'll be two countries, we will not be one country.
And you find, you found some incredible stories of resilience among some of those women in the provinces where security is an issue, where the Taliban is an issue. Can you relate what I call the Tea Party story?
Yes, this is a really inspiring story. It was reported to me by a woman who came to see me from Kandahar. I don't know exactly where it took place, but she told me the story of this widow who had to leave her village and go to Kabul to be able to make a living for herself and her children. And on one of her visits back to the village, she goes to visit a cousin who also is a widow, and finds out that the cousin has been just dislodged from her home and her little piece of land around the home, very modest home. Both she and her cousin are illiterate, don't know how to read and write. And she finds out that she's been dislodged by the newly arrived Taliban. So she says, "Okay, I'm going to deal with it." She takes three glasses, you know, we drink tea in glasses in the provinces. Three glasses, fills a teapot with hot tea and goes there, enters the room and greets the people, puts the three glasses in front of the three people. I think the head was in the middle and two people were there, and starts pouring tea for them. And then she sits down and she starts talking with them. You know, first it's just, the usual talk of how are you fine, how are your children, your family's fine, yes, my family's fine, all this. And then she starts telling them very nicely that, you know, this is the house of my cousin, and she's a widow, do you know? She has seven children, and you know, her husband has died several years before. And you know, she really relies on this piece of land around the house for having some food. You know, she plants, she cultivates it and has some food. And it went on 1 hour, 2 hours. At the third hour, she kept repeating and kept saying, you know, at the third hour, without even talking to her, the commander, the Taliban commander, takes the Kalashnikov he had between his knees, stands up and tells his guys, let's go, we're going to another house. So very calmly and very quietly, she negotiated the Taliban getting out of the house of her cousin and had her cousin reinstated in her house. That shows you, women are strong. They have their own way of doing things. They don't come barging. They don't go and say, oh, what is this? Who do you think you are? And where did you come from? And what are your... No, but they are persistent and they keep pushing and pushing and pushing until their voice is heard. And in this case, it was heard.
I love that story. Well, you know, and what about, though, a more formal role for women in peace negotiations? I mean, of course, when the Taliban came in and forced women to wear burqas and not leave the house without a man, wouldn't ban girls from schools. And now you've got 40% of students in Afghanistan are girls. Mm-hmm. There's been tremendous progress. And there's pressure from a lot of organizations, the Afghan Women's Network, to put women at the peace table, and B, talk about women's issues or women's rights as part of that process. What's your perspective on that?
I think it's not yet the time for it. I think we don't really have negotiation yet.
Okay.
So whether or not there are women in the negotiating team is really a moot question. Yes, there has been a lot of meetings and there has been a lot of come back and forth and going to Qatar and going to Saudi Arabia and I don't know what and I don't know what. But all of this has resulted in nothing. I think women have their role where they are living, if they have Taliban families there, to interact with those families. And often they do, because you know when you coexist with other people, you have issues together. Maybe there is a question of water that needs to be divided. Maybe there is a question of a school that needs a teacher. Maybe there is a question, I don't know. Common things, when people live together, they share concerns and problems. I don't think it's time for the women to sit at the table because there is no table yet.
Okay. And the status of women there, you talked about, we had this conversation about the sort of entrepreneurial spirit you're seeing of women, that there's really a misperception about women in Afghanistan, in the media. We talked about your beautiful coat, the design of that. And can you talk about what kinds of companies you're seeing women get involved in?
Well, I've been very surprised. I've had delegation of businesswomen coming to me. And these are not small businesses. I've had factory owners. I've had women who own, who actually lease big tracts of land and try to cultivate vegetables on it. I've had women who trade in dried nuts, in carpets. Of course, there's also the women who trade in hamak duzi and all this, all the embroidery things. Women are very savvy. They just need a little bit of push. They need just a little bit of support. They need a little bit of encouragement. But once they are given the space, they perform. They get results. They get things done. I mean, I see there's maybe half of the audience is women tonight. And women know that when they put their mind to it, they really get it done, no matter what it is, whether it's something at home or something at work. If they put their mind at it, they really get it done. And I've been really very pleasantly surprised to see their savviness and to see what they would ask. For example, they would say, as women, we are not getting good deals at the banks. You know, when we go for a loan, the banks will not give us loans without us putting as collateral our whole house. And, you know, we ask for a small loan, and here they want the whole house. Why don't they take, for example, our car as a collateral? And which is really a very reasonable thing. A car is still valuable and might be the value of the loan. So I find them usually that they will talk to me about their problems, but they will tell me what is the solution. So I find it much easier to help them. Because if ever it's talking to a certain agency, my colleagues do that, and we have helped a couple of women like that. It's also very encouraging to see how determined they are to make it, and to make it for their daughters and for their children and for the country. They're very patriotic.
So you gave a speech in Oslo not long ago, and you said Afghan women need to reclaim their past. In an Islamic tradition, and you cited a number of powerful women. Can you talk about a couple of those?
yes. I may be, it's kind of a the luck of the fact that I left Afghanistan just before the Civil War. So I left it during its heyday. I had lived 4 years there. I lived within the family of my husband, so I've lived with my in-laws, with the extended family, and I saw what the situation was and what Afghan culture really was. It's a culture that's very harmonious. Of course, there were problems like there are in any society, but people lived in harmony with each other. They knew what their place was. They knew what was expected from them. There was no gap, for example, with the between city and province. Members of the family that lived in the province would come and stay for extended times, so sometimes 2 weeks, 3 weeks, with us. We would go back and stay with them. There was a back and forth all the time. We would spend our weekends in the closest province. This is what I call Afghan culture, in which women were respected. Mm-hmm. My mother-in-law, my husband's grandmother, were powerful women. And yet there were women that stayed at home. It was not because they worked outside. There were other members of the family that worked outside, and they were also quite respected. And I never heard somebody say, oh, she's working outside. She's, you know, who is she? No, on the contrary, we had one who got a PhD in history and became member of the Academy of Science. Another one was when the hospital, the Jumhuriyat Hospital, Shafakhani Jumhuriyat, was open. She got the job, the prestigious job of managing. She became the manager of the hospital. So, from my little microcosm of this family, I could tell that women had their place in society and their role was respected and appreciated. And this is something that I would like to, this is why I'm saying I want to revive Afghan culture. Now, I also saying we have to go back to our Islamic roots, because in Islam, women were very important, especially in those first few decades.
In the 1920s.
I'm talking about the prophet's time.
Oh, the prophet. I'm sorry.
Much longer.
We're going to talk about the queen that we were going to talk about. Okay.
No, we'll talk about the queen later.
Yeah.
Anyway, but in Islam, the prophet married one of the most important traders of Saudi Arabia, and she was a woman. You know, this woman had caravans that were going all the way to the Mediterranean and all the way to the Persian Gulf. His daughter married Ali against, she had lots of suitors, but she preferred to marry for love. So that's again another interesting notion, that marriage for love. There were the sister of Hassan and Hussein. They were the one who did, kind of fought. They were warriors and they really fought. So what I'm trying to say is that in Islam, the place of women is an important place. The kind of Islam that is now taking place is being kind of presented to all the young generation. It's no longer that. It's actually not Islam. It's just I wouldn't say it's a variation because it's not variation. It's something else. I was making a speech one day for a an event that was about midwives and OBGYN doctors. And do you know that in Islam, it says very, in the Holy Quran, it says very clearly that there should be 30 months between children, between the birth of children. It says it very clearly for the health of the child and for the health of the mother. So for Christ's sake, I mean. These distortion of Islam, we should not accept them. We should really kind of get back to the basis, to what really it is, go back to the texts, study them, and understand them. Now, you mentioned Queen Suraya. Queen Suraya was the wife of Abdurrahman, King Abdurrahman, at the beginning of the 20th century, in the 1920s. She was an educated woman, and she became the Minister of Education. She held a cabinet position. And it seems to me, it's my guess, that she really is the person who built the foundation for a very strong educational system that existed in Afghanistan before the Civil War. The education system which which allowed people like my husband to arrive for his university studies. My husband and his cohort, when they came to the American University of Beirut, they had no problem adjusting. They knew as much as the others, and actually sometimes they had covered in things like physics and chemistry, they had covered the subjects that they were being taught to freshmen. We had a wonderful educational system thanks to Queen Suraya, who sent a lot of people on scholarship but insisted that they should study education. They wanted to become doctors, engineers, lawyers, what have you. No, they had to study education. They came back and they were the headmaster and headmistresses of the schools. They were the professors in the university and they did a great job educating generations of Afghans. And this is why the older generation of Afghans are all very well read, very well educated, know what they're talking about, know their history, know their geography, know their sciences. And thanks to this one woman. So I think Afghan women are really, when they put their mind to it, they're really quite formidable.
And let's talk about you, speaking of someone who seems almost like a role model, but you were raised Lebanese Christian, mm-hmm. In a pretty illustrious family. Talk about what your father did.
My father came from modest background, but had a scholarship and went and studied agriculture in in Lebanon, in France at the time. I'm French educated, by the way. But when he came back, he proceeded to really put together the agriculture of the country. He introduced varieties of fruits, varieties of new varieties of vegetables. He introduced fertilizers, insecticides, pesticides. Eventually, he got into water treatment, into food industries. He was really quite a pioneer. And even at one point, he was approached to become the head of the FAO. But my mother said, no, I'm not leaving Lebanon. And so he stayed at home.
So you left, though. You studied in Paris. Mm-hmm. You talked about 1968 and the uprisings having an impact on your thinking.
I was there, and the pension de famille in which I lived was in the middle of all the events, so I was in first lines to see what was happening. I did not take part, because at the time I was still very young and I didn't really understand what was happening. But it certainly what stayed with me is that you can be an agent of change by seeing what was happening in May 68, seeing all these students trying to change the curriculum, change the way teaching was done. In France at the time, it was done in a very hierarchical way, nothing like the American system. You attended large classes, probably larger than this, the number of students. And down there would be the teacher who'd do his lecture, mm-hmm. and that would be it. Mm-hmm. Then you had to study on your own, nothing like... And so they wanted to change that system, and I think they did change it in some ways. Like all revolutions, some things stuck, some things did not.
Didn't. But, and then you... You worked as a journalist for a time. You were studied at Columbia, journalism at Columbia. And how did that affect your thinking and how you look at things?
I love gathering information. That's how it has affected me. I mean, very unconsciously, I hear a piece of information here, a piece of information here. I like to put them together and understand things. I'm very... I'm eager to understand the environment in which I am. And
sounds like how you're approaching your,
yes,
your position.
Yes,
now.
This is the way I function. I like to know who are the people around me, what are the problems. And it happened in all places where I've lived. When I was here in Washington, my husband was at the World Bank, and I joined something that's called the World Bank Family Network, which welcomes new families. Families of new staff, and help them adapt to Washington, D.C., and help them understand. So we would see what their needs were. And for example, at one point, they needed English classes, and we kind of, okay, we organized English classes. Mm-hmm. Some other point, they needed some financial education. You know, some of them would come and didn't know how to do a budget, because they always lived in a big family, and everybody taking care of them. So we had financial classes with budget first, and then it went all the gamut till we had an investment club too, which is still functioning. I saw them the other day. I do like to solve problems. So maybe it's this combination of trying to get the information and then solving the problems, yes.
So being raised Lebanese Christian, and you started down a professional path, but you had small children, and mm-hmm. you ended up in Afghanistan with your husband. Was there a cultural, any kind of cultural barriers to you there, or did you fit right in? You did not convert to Islam.
No,
correct?
I did not. Afghanistan is... I spent 4 years in Afghanistan as a young bride. Then we went to the States. Mm-hmm. And we came here for my husband's PhD and ended up staying 30 years because of the civil war. And actually, It was advised, my husband was advised not to go back because most of his family was put in prison at the time. So we stayed. But the 4 years when I came to Afghanistan were very easy to me. Lebanese culture and Afghan culture are not very different. We eat the same food. We have the same respect for elders. We have the same way of being welcoming to guests. Of you know, it's. I remember once I had just. I don't know if I was already married or because I went first as a. My father came to me as a fiancé, and then we got married in Lebanon, and went back to Kabul. But I remember there was this couple that came, and they were young, maybe 2 or 3 years they had been married. But he was Afghan, and she was German, and they had a little boy. And she was surprised that I was so relaxed. And she was, she had come, they had come to visit us, and she was with her mother-in-law. And I must say her mother-in-law was a little bit formidable, but anyway. But she said, you know, how can you manage? I said, what is there to manage? And she says, well, when we sit at the table, my mother-in-law is always saying, here, take, eat. Why don't you eat from that? Why don't you take that? Why don't you take that? I said, but she's taking care of you. She's showing respect. She's showing she likes you. Oh, she said. I thought, but I told her no. And once I say no, it's no. She should not insist. So for her, it was a clash of culture. But for me, I knew that my mother would have done exactly the same thing back home.
Or any Italian mother would do the same
yes.
thing.
Yes, yes, indeed, indeed.
You've been, you are an Afghan citizen, but nevertheless, you were criticized by some for not being Islamic during the campaign, not being Islamic, not being in your Lebanese roots. Some people saying this country shouldn't have you as First Lady. How did you deal with that?
A lot of people say a lot of things.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, you say I'm Christian. I was born in a Christian family, but I was an Eastern Christian, which meant that we prayed in Arabic. Okay? So Muslims pray in Arabic. And when you pray to God, there's that much vocabulary for praying. Mm-hmm. You know, so it was pretty much the same. Mm-hmm. So I don't feel uncomfortable, for example, saying Muslim prayers, because they are exactly or pretty much like my Christian prayers. Mm-hmm. So for me, it's not a difference whether I'm Muslim or Christian. And for the people, for all the delegations that come to see me, it has never been an issue. They are just happy that I'm there, that I'm opening my doors to them, that I'm listening to what they have to say, and that maybe I'll be able to help them.
And it seems like that works well. I've been told you've got a caretaker gene. You like to take care of people. When you came back to Afghanistan, you got involved in the school ASEAN. Can you describe that?
Yes. ASEAN is a school that was started by Afghans to take care of the children who work on the streets. And I've always liked that organization because the children are the ones that pay the price of civil war, because they find themselves with either with no parents or with parents that have been debilitated or have no, not able to work, and they are the ones who have to earn a living for the family. And so I've tried to help ASEAN as much as I could. Basically, whenever we had a dinner at home and there were some foreigners, I would tell them about ASEAN. And often some of them would come and visit and would make a donation. And little by little, we created an ASEAN foundation here in the States so that American supporters could benefit from the 501c tax deduction and yet help a institution that they really liked. So this is what ASEAN is. And
Well, I've heard about it for years, I should say, from Trish Silberman, who is right here and is partly responsible for you being here.
Yes.
So thank you, Trish.
And actually, Mary Jo Myers, the head of the foundation now, is sitting right there, too.
Welcome. Yes. I love how you are very outspoken about a lot of things. And one of the, in your speech, you made the point that international aid has created a culture of dependency in the country. How would you go about, first, how does that manifest itself? And secondly, how would you go about tackling that?
Okay, what I mean by that is that humanitarian assistance is wonderful, but it's short-lived, and it does not change the situation. Bringing food, bringing blankets, bringing tents, bringing floor covers, all that is wonderful for people who really need it. But you come back the next year and they're still there, and there are even more people that are there. I don't think that humanitarian assistance is the answer. And especially, don't send clothes. Kabul has a whole market of secondhand clothes. Anyway, what I think needs to be done is to get to the roots of the problem. Why are these people in camps? Why are they, they are usually internally displaced people. They've been displaced maybe because of civil war where they are. They may have been displaced because some warlord decided to take away their land. They may have been displaced because there has been a flood or a landslide. The solution to this problem is not to bring them every year that much, their well-known ration of rice, sugar, flour, oil, cooking oil, two blankets, and one tarp. It does not solve the problem. So basically, what I would like from the agencies, the international aid people, is to stop thinking in terms of humanitarian assistance and start thinking in terms of development. And developing institutions means training people. It's very easy to come and to help and to say, here, I'm going to show you how it's done. No. It's like I was at a dinner recently and they were talking about how the Afghans are at the wheel and they're having their hands on the wheel also to help them stir. And I said, no, take off your hands from the wheel, let them drive as if it was a driving school car and you have a emergency brake next to you, you can pull if ever something wrong. But let them drive, let them learn to drive. As long as you have the hands off the wheel, they will not learn how to drive. You will leave and everything will fall apart. So basically what I'm trying to say is really train people to lead, train people to be in charge. Let them make mistakes. People learn from their mistakes. They're not going to learn by seeing you do things. So basically this is how I'm trying to tackle it. I'm not really quite sure how I'm going to do it though.
Are there models that you would cite as that's the way to do it?
Not that I know of. I'm sure there are, but I'm sure my husband knows, and I'll rely on him to tell me.
Speaking of training people, one of your other frustrations is that Afghans who go to the West to become educated, to go to university, and then don't want to come back. And you want to talk about that more, you told me.
Yes. There have been quite a few young people who have had scholarship to come and study. I know that in the United States there are about 300 of them this year altogether. So it gives you an idea. It has started several years back. So there have been quite a few. There is a tendency for them not to want to come back to Afghanistan. And here I would like to say, I don't know if there are some here in the audience, but please remember, this money was given to you not because of your beautiful eyes. It was given to you because you are going to go back to your country and help rebuild your country. So at least you spent 2 years here, go spend 2 years back in Kabul. Then you want to come back to the States, well and good, I have no problems. But you have at least to repay all this money that has been spent on you. Now somebody mentioned that I should say, you know, the amount that was spent on you, this is the amount that you should repay if you want to stay in the States. I think this might be a little too harsh, but still, if ever it comes to that, that's what I will advise to do. People should have, should feel that they have to come back and help their country. How is this country going to grow if the people that we train and we send to the best universities here decide, oh, well, I'd rather stay here? I tell you.
So I'm going to ask one more question, and we're going to open this up to audience questions. I want to remind you, it needs to be a short question. It has to end with a question mark and not and not be getting on a soapbox. But let me ask you, you've got a room full of people. I've heard you say a number of times, you've got cameras. I've heard you say a number of times that you're frustrated with the coverage of Afghanistan and the image that's portrayed in the Western media. Tell us, what is the real Afghanistan that we're missing?
Okay. You have to understand, foreign NGOs, foreign agencies need to justify why they are working in Afghanistan. So they need to say that the sky is falling, you know? They need to say, oh, the situation is terrible, it's horrible, because otherwise they will not be able to raise the funds they need to function there, okay? So somehow this has kind of gotten to the journalists, and I think it's laziness on the part of the journalists because they just need to go around and see for themselves. And I've read somewhere that, Afghanistan is the worst country for a girl to be born in. Oh, gosh. It's not true. There are difficult situations, there are difficult challenges, but still you can have a good life in Afghanistan. We need to work for it, we need to improve it, there is a lot of room for improvement, but it's a beautiful country and it's a beautiful people. So basically what I resist is when I see an article that writes that, oh, everything is going wrong in Afghanistan. Oh, the economy is going is falling apart. Security, there is no security in Afghanistan. 34 million people live in Afghanistan. And, you know, maybe, I don't know the number of people that are being killed, and it's really too much. Every life counts, but is probably less than the number of people that get killed on the roads here in the United States. So let's keep a relative view. Let's be a little more upbeat about the country. Also now there is a change. It's a new administration. There are real hopes that certain things that the press has criticized at length, like corruption and lack of governance, so nepotism and all this, maybe these things are going to be tackled a little better. So let's be hopeful, let's be positive. I think Afghanistan is going to be a beautiful country, and I hope all of you will be able one day to come and visit.
You're a good representative of your country.
Thank you.
We have time for a few questions.
Margaret.
Where are the mics? Right here in the front.
Good evening.
Identify yourself.
My name is Marzia. And I came to the United States through the Initiative to Educate Afghan Women program. Mm-hmm. I'm very happy, and it's a historical time for me today to be here to listen to my role model and our First Lady. I will never forget today.
Thank you.
And the first thing I would like to say...
We're going to ask a question. We have a very short period of time.
Okay, just a comment. The students who don't go to Afghanistan, they are working here. They are working for their country, for their people, and for their women. And we would love to go back, and we will go back. But we want the security to be to protect us. We need protection and security.
Okay. Do you want to respond to that?
Yeah, I know. Situation is probably not ideal for girls who want to work in Afghanistan, but it's getting much better. And if you want to change the situation, you have to be part of it. That's how I think. But thank you for trying to do something from here anyway. And I've been talking with people at the embassy, and maybe by the end of the academic year, we'll try to have like a job fair for you to know what kind of jobs are available in Afghanistan and to kind of connect people with qualification with jobs that would be appropriate.
Other questions? Right here.
Hi, my name is Margaret Rogers, and I'm proud to be on the board of the Ashanna Foundation. I've also worked in Afghanistan. My question is about the Taliban. You started out, Rula, saying that there was not much progress with regard to the peace talks, but as somebody who has lived there in a Taliban-dominated province, are there prospects for a more peaceful country given the strength of the Taliban?
I don't think I say something that you don't know, but the first priority of my husband is to bring security to Afghanistan. And I have a lot of confidence in him. I think he knows how to think outside the box and how to figure out how to solve problems. He's a problem solver too. So I hope that eventually the situation will get much better.
Any specifics? Moving forward, do you want to reveal?
No, I don't know. No, we don't live in each other's pockets, so I don't know what he's doing.
Back here.
Thank you. Rahim Rashidi from Kurdistan TV. Mm-hmm. Thank you for your time. What is your opinion of Kurdish female freedom fighter? Thank you.
Kurdish female fighters.
I am very proud of them. I think they're taking part. They're taking part in defending their country, and I think they're doing very well. And we do have females in the Afghan army. I met the ones that are at the academy. There are all 36 of them, and they're bright young women. They made me feel very proud to have them with me. And I hope that they'll be able one day to defend their country, too.
Where are the mics? Are the mics nearby here? Oh, I'm sorry, right next to you, yeah. Right here.
Hello, my name is Elise Hampton. I want to thank you for taking the time to come out this evening and speak with us. My question is very simple.
Can you speak a little louder, please?
Sure. Yeah. If there were three things, and you could prioritize them in order, that Afghanistan needs, what would they be?
That Afghanistan needs, what would they be? Okay. I think the first thing is security. The second thing is greater order in the way the country is being managed. So better management of the country. And the third thing, I don't know. I really feel once there will be security and once the country is, the mechanism of governing the country are really in place, people will find, each person will find something that they will want to do, and they will take part in building their own country. I don't think Afghans need to be told that they should be proud of their country, that they should serve their country. They have it, it's innate in them. But it's just the circumstances were not provided.
Right here.
Thank you. Ma'am, my name is Major Mike Marin. I'm with the United States Army, mm-hmm. and I'll be deploying to Afghanistan in June for a program called AFPAC Hands. What advice would you give to me as an advisor? I'll be working with counterparts, more than likely with either the Ministry of Interior or Ministry of Defense. I'd like to know what kind of advice would you give me when I'm advising an Afghan? Thank you, ma'am.
Well, thank you for your service. But what I would like to say, so you'll be either in the Ministry of Interior or the Ministry of Defense, is that what you're saying? Okay. Try to help bring order in those ministries. And if you see corruption, don't look the other way. Unfortunately, I think often foreign advisors see corruption and are worried to step on people's toes. And particularly in those two ministries, if you can enforce the respect of women, because unfortunately it does not exist in those two ministries.
And we didn't touch on that much corruption. I mean, do you see that getting better?
Yes. I think people are a little more wary of engaging in corruption. I'll tell you an anecdote. I don't know whether it's true or not, but I heard it when my husband became president. There was a whole list of people, maybe 60 names, of people who wished to become ministers. The minute they found out my husband was going to be president, they withdrew. So I think it doesn't mean that there is no corruption anymore. No, there is, it's systemic. And I think what my husband is trying to do is to deal with it by building systems that will make it less possible for people to be corrupt, yes.
I think we have time for one more.
Right here.
Hey there, I'm Hannah, and I just wanted to ask this question on behalf of all the Afghans in the West.
Can you talk slower and louder?
Oh, sure, I can. I just wanted to ask this question on behalf of all the Afghans in the West, the youth. And I wanted to ask you, what can we do to help rebuild Afghanistan? What do you personally believe that what areas should we focus on?
Okay.
I say she wants to come back, so
yes,
tell her
yes,
where to go.
Yes, I think it will be good at first to come for a short trip for you to see. Maybe we can, we had talked about organizing activities in the summer for young people who want to come back and try and help. And because, you know, I don't know how much, it's a personal choice, and I don't want to impose on anyone to decide to stay here or to decide for them that to go to Afghanistan. Come and see, and we probably will be, this is something we've been thinking in our, I'm looking at my chief of staff here, and we've been talking about creating programs for young people in the summer, so they would come and get reacquainted with what, and I tell you, from the same family, you'll have one child who just falls in love with Kabul, and the other one says, oh, I can't wait to go back. So it will not reflect on badly on anyone if ever they don't want to stay. But if you come and you just love it, then you'll find.
Are there sectors though that really need that young talent, like teaching, for example, or engineering? I mean, are there things that stand out in your mind?
Well, there certainly must be. I don't know. Okay. I don't know myself, but because my children are older,
right.
So I don't move in circles of very young people. But I think there might be things that they can do with Ashiana, for example, or they can do with organizations that take care of young children, or even if ever they have a specific thing that they like, for example, they like art, we can get them with artists, budding artists in Afghanistan, or they like photography, we have photographers' associations. Or if they want to go in the provinces, like we can find maybe some midwife to shadow. Oh, something. I mean, I think the possibilities are immense. But I, at this point, I don't know. I've only been a first lady for 4 months, so please bear with me.
Well, you have your work cut out for you. And I just want to thank you for being not only so insightful, but frankly, I think so inspirational for a lot of the people in this